Perfect. So I think this is certainly the graveyard shift. So thank you for sticking with us. We're almost there. And we've got, 40 minutes? We originally had 20 minutes to talk through insider risk in a work from anywhere world. And now we've got 40 minutes, so we've been upgraded to the ballroom. And essentially, we're going to talk through a little bit about some of the trends we're seeing from an insider risk perspective, but then ultimately wanted to give you a sense of what technology looks like and go through a bit of the demo. So just by way of introduction, in terms of meeting the experts, it's myself, Dan Cousineau. I'm the compliance marketing manager at Microsoft, and I'm joined by Graham Hosking, who is the director of advisory services at Lighthouse, one of our key partners, and Ali Turnbull, a cloud solution architect. Before we begin, just want to say a big thank you to our sponsors. Without said sponsorship, we wouldn't be here today at the Cousineau Summit. Okay, so before we begin, I just wanted to maybe take 2 minutes to ask some questions around what are the, and just encourage you to think about this, what are your key challenges when it comes to compliance? Is it the 250 updates per day across 750 different regulatory bodies? Is it an influx of data you're seeing with inside your organization? Is it just knowing where that data sits and ultimately who has access to that data? And I just encourage you to think about what are some of the key challenges you're experiencing, both from a partner perspective and from a customer perspective in terms of where that data sits. So for us, insider risk between us is certainly a narrative we're trying to land in the UK. And it's become a universal concern. So we recently done a study which went out to 1,000 data protection officers and chief information security officers, of which 93% stated they were very concerned with insider risk, and 66% stated they were highly concerned. Now, this is because we've seen a mass migration over the last couple of years to remote working, and ultimately this is there's no longer physical presence in the office where managers can see their staff, what they're doing, and as a result, organizations no longer have visibility into where that data is going. So in addition to that, we've also seen the average cost of an insider rise to 11.5 million, and this is up from 8 million the year before. And it's about 77 days in terms of the average duration to contain insider risk incident. Now, this isn't just necessarily the financial implications in terms of a breach by insider risk or the ICO that our the ICO that aren't necessarily charging fines in relation to insider risk, but it's also the brand and reputation damage. So we've seen it from very public GDPR exposures that organizations have spent a lot of money to essentially repair their damage for insider risk remote a certain breach. And one of the things we find is 25% of companies that are going through a data breach have 25% of organizations that have been exposed to a data breach, 25% of them have come from an insider risk incident. So there's quite a broad range of insider threat. It's not necessarily just data theft or data leakage, albeit these are the most prevalent that we're seeing, but also think about workplace harassment, and again, shout out to the drawings by one of our interns, Becky, who's done this, but it's not just about data theft and data leakages, but also think about workplace harassment. How can organizations turn around and state they have they're proactively looking at the culture if they're not, or fostering a culture of inclusivity if they're not necessarily tracking the profanity that's being used across the M365 services. So again, not just about data theft or data leakage, but also other threats that we're seeing. So a few organizations we're speaking to are using a very fractured approach to insider risk. So we had one conversation with a company that are using a user activity monitoring solution. They're feeding signals into a user entity behavior analytics solution to try and find that insider risk needle in the haystack. This is on-prem, it's an old way of looking at it, it's quite clunky. It's not real-time, and ultimately it's not serving back a richness of information. So we're certainly seeing that, you know, they're spending a lot of money on insider risk, and we know from the ground up building solutions like this requires a lot of engineering resource. So at Microsoft, we have over 800,000 SharePoint sites, of which you know, we have over 100,000 employees. So calling all this data together in terms of patterns that would relate to an insider risk is quite a tricky and expensive approach. So, you know, engineering resources are required for traditional ways of looking at user entity behavior analytics solutions. So it's essentially we're seeing that, you know, organizations today are using a very fractured approach to this, hence why for the last 5 years we've been developing this tool to go to market. So what I would say, we're going to go into a demo of insider risk shortly, but what I would encourage you to think about is there is, when setting up an insider risk practice, this is not just an information security, it's not just an information security problem, it's not just a HR problem, it's not just an IT problem. It's actually a combination of all these business functions need to come together to identify these sorts of patterns. So when setting up an insider risk practice, you want to have a committee that consists of a HR function, legal, SecOps. If we look at Microsoft from an internal perspective, we have lots of different functions across the UK. We have our Cambridge department, our research department in Cambridge. They're going to have a different insider risk management practice to what we may have in sales and marketing, for example. So our policies that Microsoft has set up on the research department is completely different to what policies has been set up to other internal staff. And this has only come forward because of the communication and collaboration that we've had across the engineering teams, just to say this is what who has access to more sensitive data, and therefore they should have different policies compared to what another group should have, for example. There's certainly a dichotomy between privacy and security. So although with this type of technology we're increasing the security aspect, how much then do you give away from a privacy perspective? So it's very much a taboo subject that needs to sort of be addressed inside the customer base today. And I think the best part of being able to address that conversation is to have it, but it must be across multiple business functions. It's not just a HR or a SecOps issue. So with that, we'll just move on to a demo and round. So everyone have just a question on that.
Excellent. So, good afternoon. I've got a question for you all, right? The question on the screen says, do you know anyone who's taken potentially sensitive information from a workplace? Or have you taken data from your workplace that would benefit you somewhere else, right? And that could be... You don't have to share anymore. So this could be really a project we've been working on for the last like couple of months. You know, it's your project, it's your kind of blood, sweat, and tears. I'm going to take it with me to take it to my new employer, you know, because that's going to help me. I'm going to be able to promote myself and all this, right? And there's one side of that where it's not sensitive information, but sometimes like things that are NDA with Microsoft, for example, if you're moving from a big company to a competitor, that could be particularly bad, right? So it's just those kind of thoughts. Yes, thanks very much. I mean, it's Microsoft, by the way. And with that, right, it's not just around technology, but it's also around the business processes, right? So just as Dan said, you know, there's got to be people in the business that are doing this today, right? They're doing it sort of reactive. Like something has happened, something's been surfaced up to HR. hey, you know, Ali's been shouting at me, like, on chat. And everything is after the fact, and we're collecting that data, right? We've got tools to be able to do that as well. But let's be more proactive to that. So we're speaking to the business to say, what are the kind of typical things that will make your life easier? Is that understanding what is target harassment or abuse or discriminatory, say that word, discriminatory language that's happening? So we can use those tools to be able to surface up that natural language. And then with other signals or other behaviors, we can surface up that risk score to say, like, this is pretty risky stuff. You want to go away and investigate that. So this part of this slide really is saying that there's a process of actually implementing this technology. But the takeaway I want for you today is talk to the business. Right? Setting up these tools and lighting up the tools takes like 5 minutes. Like, you'll see that at the end of the day. But talk to the business about how they should implement this technology and what's in it for them, what's the output is the most important. So before I go into a demo, I did a really jazzy eye chart for you. Okay, this is more of a takeaway. But when I was talking to customers about this technology, they didn't really grasp about like how it all hangs together, what can it do, what do I need, what licenses do I need, right? So when I built this out, over on the left-hand side, is all the different signals that you can pull from the platform, right? And that could be things like trainable classifiers or the sensitive information types to understand different types of data. But also if you're a customer that has cloud app security or using Defend for Endpoint, license for Endpoint DLP, then we can use those signals as well that will feed into insider risk management. And guess what? Everybody's using Azure AD because they need to log on, right? So we can take those behavior analytics as well from Azure to understand when you're logging on. So I know Ali logs on from 9 to 5. Great, thanks Ali. And I log on 9 to 5, but now I log on late at night. Now I'm downloading a lot of content from SharePoint. Now I'm printing a lot of PII information off because I want to take it with me, right? I'm going to leave Microsoft. So we can pull on all those different signals. I didn't do this, by the way. And we can we can pull up all those different signals, but before we go in and create the policies, because we spoke to the business, we know what they want, sort of, and then we can go in and we create these policies to detect those behaviors, those changes. Wouldn't it be really nifty if we could go back the last 30 days to get a sample of what's actually happening in our organization? So in preview at the moment, Microsoft has this tool called Insider Risk Analytics. So that means you can press go, and in a 24-hour time period, it's actually going through a sample of the 365 audit logs. It's going through Exchange and understanding what attachments might contain sensitive information, and it's also seeing those going outside of your organization as well. So you're better informed about what types of policies this tool can actually help you with. And then from there, you're more informed, so you can go in and create your policies. So there's templates already built for you that you can and we'll go into that in a bit of demo in a second. And once we've created those policies, as users are surfacing up this weird, risky behavior, then it feeds into the alert. So you as a reviewer, or you as your security team, or HR, or legal, are going to go into this tool and understand what types of risks are important to you, right? And then you can look at the evidence of that. So we can decide, as part of those alerts then, do we want to carry that on to a case? There's some case management tools built into here as well. And that allows you to review the evidence. And the most important part of the whole insider risk stack is everything is anonymized. We don't actually know, you know, it's you who has been downloading and moving information. We want to be able to protect your privacy as well. So if you think of other organizations around the world, specifically Germany, right? They have laws to be able to protect the identity of their workforce. So it's really important to understand these solutions are anonymized by default. You know, later down the line, later part of that process, you're going to have to find out who that individual is. But when we're reviewing the evidence in front of us, it means that we don't have bias against that person, right? There might be a manager or a friend, it might be Ali that I'm going to throw into the bus, right? So by taking away that bias and just look at the core evidence and realize that either it was something unintentional, right? We sent an email through a wrong email address with some sensitive information. Right? I did it once, you know, I was busy. Okay, slap on the wrist, don't do it again. Read our policies. Or if it was something that was intentional, right? I was taking data or I was expressing harassment behavior, then we can take that to legal as a contributor and then we can start to build that evidence in our e-discovery cases as well. So that's kind of a triage process at the very bottom here, either notifying the user that they've done something wrong, and we can see that in the tool as well, but maybe they're a re-offender, or we can escalate this further to say, right, we need to take legal action on that person now. And also in preview at the very top of this slide is some API capabilities. So the management, the activity management API in 365 allows you to suck in all of these insider risk alerts, and then we can use things like Sentinel, and we can use logic apps to be able to do things a lot more automated, right? Who wants to be in a dashboard or in a portal today, like manually reviewing things? Nobody does. But we've got tools like Power Automate and logic apps to do things like put it into your favorite ITSM solution, right? Or notify the manager of that user, say, you want to chat with them first, let me know. Or give some options to that manager to say, hey, you know, Graham left like a month ago, right? Red alert, it shouldn't be in our systems. Go and lock it all down, right? So we can have automation around that. And then lastly, to kill your slides, is analytics, right? So, like showing this as a live demo is pretty hard because you have to have a lot of data, a lot of activities are happening. But these are the types of stats you'll have when you first turn on the solution. So this is saying, hey, of the data we found in the last 30 days, like 1.3% of your users are performing exfiltration activities. And it gives you a feel for what sensitive information is being sent out. And then it's informing you of what policies you need to set up. So with that, let's move into a live demo and sacrifice something to the demo gods. Okay, so we're over in the compliance portal. Oh yes, because you can't see that. Nobody said anything. Like usually on my Teams calls when I'm trying to show something I'm not sharing on screen yet. But you still can't see it. You see that now? Amazing. So anyway, we're over in the compliance portal in Insider Risk Management. And Microsoft done a really good job about giving you the steps in order to enable this functionality, right? So there was a Microsoft Docs article, and there's about five different steps you have to walk through, like turning on audit capabilities. So you can read on the screen here, but one that is still missing on the screen is you need to license those individuals you're monitoring. If you don't do that, you're not going to get any stats for them, right? So you need to make sure they are licensed specifically for this tool. And then when we drill down into this overview then, we get some kind of high-level statistics about what policies are triggering. If we go down to our users, we've got these random GUIDs, so we're anonymizing that data to prevent that bias and protecting our identity. And then further on down, this is the analytics I talked about. I'm not going to review the results here because it's blank. But you get a feel for where to go to be able to see those results. So as part of that kind of eye chart that I gave you earlier on, the first thing you're probably going to go away and do is create some policies, right? So let's go in. I've got a number of policies already set up within this tenant. And if we go through the process, you'll start to see the templates that are built in. These are fully customizable, by the way. So if we want to create like a general data leaks policy, that means that I can set this up and then reuse assets that I might have already set up in the platform. Anybody using data loss prevention today? Yes, nods. Okay. So you've set those policies up. Those policies are already set up, so you can tell the system when a DLP policy hits and triggers. Also, have a look at that user's behavior as well and surface that up as an insider risk alert if it is risky activity, right? So we could say this is going to be data leaks, and the next thing I'm going to say, who do I want to monitor? Everybody in our organization or just specific users and groups? Do I want to prioritize different things? Just prioritization means you're putting a risk score booster. Like, hey, all my HR data is over here. Like, monitor that, please. Because if anybody makes any data of that, I want to be first to know. Right? Or this specific classification labels you might be using, like confidential or top secret. I want to be able to monitor those as well, so we can stipulate that here as well. I'm going to skip that for now. And then this is a really cool and funky bit, right? So here I can say, choose what happens on the event, so a user performs an exfiltration activity, great. Or I can click on this other radio button, and this drop down shows me all the DLP policies I've already got set up within their platforms. Like I said, we can now not just block the end user from sending something, but we can be a bit more intelligent about, hey, you're allowed to do this in certain circumstances, but if you're doing something else and your behavior changes, then I want that to surface up in sort of risk management. And then these are all the indicators. So this is a bunch of stuff from Office 365. So if I'm trying to move data in SharePoint or download it or delete it or obfuscate it, then we can monitor that. We've also got device indicators. This is pretty cool because if you spoke to Microsoft about 2-3 years ago, we were very hell-bent on, I say we as Microsoft still, we're still very hell-bent, or we're very hell-bent on everything moving to the cloud. But then now we're cognizant that data doesn't just sit in the cloud or on-prem, it also sits at the endpoint in front of you as well. So we can light up the same sensor that's built into Windows 10 that actually gets used as part of Defender for Endpoint and Endpoint DLP to be able to monitor things like copying to USB or dragging from your desktop a very sensitive file into your personal Dropbox account. Right? That might be part of your job and you're allowed to do that, but now we can monitor those activities as well as block them or block with a business justification. Right? So and there's other things we pull on as well. If you're using cloud app security, then we can see mass download, or if you've left the organization, we can trigger that as well. We've also got sequence detection. So if you're trying to do a number of different things, a number of different activities to take data, like change the name, move into a different folder, now I'm going to download it, now I'm going to print it, then it will detect the sequence as well. And me, as the reviewer of this, it will actually tell me to say this is like 200% above normal behavior for great or not great, this person, right, that we're investigating. And then we can have other risk score boosters as well. And once we've done that, this is very new, this came out the other week. We had feedback from customers where they wanted to customize the tool a lot more than you could. So now there is literally pages of customizations and kind of fine tweaking and tuning of this tool as well. So you can rock on with that. And then once we've done that, very quickly, it start to trigger alerts as those cases come in. We can escalate to a case as well. I'm fast forwarding this to the cool and funky bit, which is we can see a timeline of all the events for this user as well. So we can go back 6 months. Right? So if we take the example of me, thanks, and I might be working 3 months ago like I always have, right? I'm downloading maybe NDA content or classified content. I'm logging late at night because, you know, I'm workaholic. But as time went on and then I'm handing in my resignation, we can pull those external signals from our HR system to say, look, Graham is leaving on this date. And then the combination of what's happened in the past and what's happening in the future may coincide with different activities that raise the risk score. So what the hell am I about? What I'm trying to say is the individual activities might not be risky enough on their own, but the combination of all those activities means that I might have a risk score of like 90 out of 100 because of all these different things have happened. And we can see that within here as well. We go over to the visualization here, we can say, right, show me what happened for this person, this anonymized person, the last 6 months. And what we can see here is we've got different colored balls, and the higher up the balls are, the risk in the activity. and then the different colored balls or orbs indicate what sort of activity it was. So I can click on those and get a feel about what this actually was. If we zoom in, this activity was files were downloaded from SharePoint. There was 26 events of files being downloaded from one SharePoint site. 7 events then that the system detected using sensitive information types, custom sensitive information types that you could put in, of defense terms, New Zealand health numbers randomly, financial terms, pharmaceutical, and we can also see classifications of data as well. And if that wasn't enough, we can go in to the Content Explorer and the Activity Explorer, and actually preview the data this person downloaded from SharePoint. So the data has to reside in the cloud in order for me as the reviewer to be able to see it. But even if you had a sensitive file that you created on your desktop, right, on your device in front of you, and you did some risky behavior, we still see the telemetry from the endpoint, everything surfaced back up to the cloud, and you can say, right, this file was sat on your desktop that was called credit cards doc, right? We can't view it on here, but we know that it contained credit card and debit card information, so that's the smoking gun. It's really bad, right? So we can go in and we can use the native online viewers here, so we can click on these items and be able to see these files nearly in their entirety. So if it's an Excel spreadsheet, we can see all the tabs. We can view it in different ways as well. So if there's a specific search word in some of these tools, when I view it in a text mode, it actually highlight the keywords that got picked up as part of it. We can also bring in other contributors to this as well. So if I'm the reviewer within HR and I need to drag in legal, I can do that from this tool as well. So I can add in contributors and they've got permissions then to work on this case. And then we can also do other things like case notes. We can use Power Automate to maybe notify the manager or notify me or remind me maybe in a week's time that there's still something to review in the tool. And there's other preview capabilities as well where it can spin up a team in Microsoft Teams so we can have a collaborative approach to discussing this case as well. And just to finish this off, these are the kind of the triage bits. So if I decide that this person, again, they're anonymized, so I can see that here, send them an email without knowing who the person is. If it was something like unintentional, but we need to notify them, maybe they should read our terms and conditions again, or our standards of business conduct, then I can template these emails going out to the person, like slap on the wrist, go and read our policies, and then we can close the case. And we can also see in that timeline when previous insider risk management cases were closed as well. So if you're a re-offender, great, I can see that in the timeline as well. If you've done something very bad, then we can click on the actions and we can escalate for investigation. And the cool thing about this is all of the kind of tiers within Microsoft compliance all talk to each other. So as I'm raising this or escalating this for investigation, it's going to automatically create a case over in advanced discovery for me. And it's going to do that retrievals of that data, so the evidence for me, alongside the timeline of events of when that person did what. So then we can take the legal or court or get your attorney in or whichever, right? So the importance of this is not big brother. We're letting the end user do what they want to do, but it's a combination of different things that might surface up those very risky activities within your environment. There we go. So I'm going to hand back to Dan, and we're going to talk about
communication compliance. Yeah. So comms compliance is very similar to Insider Risk Manager, but it's a different module. So if you think about Insider Risk Management being user entity behavior analytics, it finds the patterns behind certain policies that we build around data theft, data leakage, etc. Communication compliance is around the comms that are being used across the organization. So again, going back to the point around if you're trying to foster a inclusive and diverse workforce, you want to be able to spot any workplace harassment that's being used. again, broad range of communication risks, from profanity being used, confidential information, adult content, harassment, threats, etc. And the reason why this is important is because of the vast amount of communication modalities there are. So being able to take all that data, ingest it into communication compliance, to spot trends where employees may be having some of these threats is a key area. So again, privacy built in, Graham mentioned it around there. You're going to see a lot of the same technology, but more pseudonymized and using the specific templates around communication. So with that, I'll go over to Ali to demo that.
So another one of these great diagrams that Graham has kind of set up for us. So we're going to kind of go through a bit about how everything all works together. So not only can we bring in everything that we've got from the Microsoft side of the thing, so we've got email, Yammer, chats within Teams, so we're actually being able to kind of, from a threading perspective, bring all of that telemetry into it. We can also look at bringing in some of those third-party connectors as well. So we've got third-party connectors from, say, Bloomberg, ICE, another Bloomberg, we've got Veritas connectors, we've got Cisco, Java, WebEx, and a lot from telemessage connectors as well, so things like WhatsApp. So bringing all of that telemetry in and thinking about that along that whole timeline as well, we're starting to get a really good picture around what's been going on. We can use the same types of tools from a telemetry perspective, so we can use the trainable classifiers that we might have already built around that information that we're looking for. So we can kind of use some of those trainable classifiers that we've got out of the box. So things like targeted harassment. So where we're kind of looking at bullying, what's going on inside the organization? Is Dan sending some not so nice messages across to Greg? And he's kind of complaining to his manager about what's actually going on. We can start to kind of look at that information as well. Not only can we look at that information from a discriminatory perspective, we can look at offensive language. We can look at images as well, so if there's any pictures or anything that's going on, any gory images, any racy images, we're starting to be able to really use the power of all the machine learning and being able to pick that up as well. Not only that, but we can actually pick it up in 7 different languages as well. So if the harassment's going on in multiple different languages, we can look at that, but we can also translate those to the person who might be reviewing those in English as well, which is pretty cool, I think. So we can use our sensitive information types as well, so we've got all the ones out of the box, so credit card information, all of those different types of ones that Graham mentioned earlier. We can create custom ones around regex, dictionary, fingerprint, exact data matching. And we can use the power of our Microsoft information protection to look at those classified documents and looking at that as well. Oops, that just went a bit fast, but anyway. So what's kind of like built around all of that is the communication compliance services. So really what that does is we've got all the policy templates that we've actually got, and I don't know if we're going to have enough time for a demo to look at those right now, but so here we go. So the policy templates that we've got, as I've mentioned to you before, is we can look for offensive language, we can look for sensitive information types, we can look for regulatory compliance as well, so in the financial industry, there's a lot of rules and regulations that we actually need to have. You think about information barriers, any of those other different types of things, we might really need to kind of look at that. So a conflict of interest between different groups, a merger, an acquisition, any of those other different types of things that might be going on. We can also create our own custom policies based on some of those templates as well. So we can monitor a subset of users, just like we can insider risk management. We can do that from different people could be reviewing that. We can have different comms channel selections, and we can do the direction of comms. So we can monitor internal, external information or outbound as well. So we've really got kind of that whole granularity. And again, as I said, we can use all those different conditions and those trainable classifiers, and then we will get a load of alerts. So once we get those alerts, we can start to kind of work out what we're going to do with those. So we've got our alert management, we can do triage against that, we can kind of look at those items, we can look at those again in Content Explorer, a bit like we were doing a little bit earlier, but then we can also annotate and redact that information. So in that Content Explorer that Graham showed you earlier, in communication compliance, we can circle different types of things, and that makes it a lot easier if we get to the point of an e-discovery case to be able to talk about those things as well. We can tag things as well, so we can bring different tags, our own personal tags into that, and we can say, well, do you know what, this is actually compliant, it's non-compliant. We could then raise, you know, a template as well to kind of say, well, do you know what, that's not standard of business conduct. We kind of can start to use that whole thing, look at that report, fake, false positive, and we can kind of remove those messages from Teams as well if we wanted to. At that particular point, once we know what we're going to do with the alert, we can then notify the user, we can escalate that for investigation, or we can have a report. To communication compliance. I'll show you a little bit around some of the policies that we can build that I actually just talked about there, and then we'll have a look at the alerting. We've only got a couple of minutes, and I think you need to wrap up as well. So it's coming Saturday. So here, as I mentioned to you before, we've got these policy templates. So we've got the one for monitoring offensive language, so that's looking at the abusive language, preventing the harassment, the sensitive information. So that's kind of looking at all those things. We'll be looking at unauthorized links, financial, regulatory, and then the conflict of interest. So if we have a look at some of those particular ones, so let's say what's going on in project code names. Let's have a look at some of the alerts that we can actually start to get. I think originally when the product actually came out was that we were just bringing out like one line from, you know, we picked it up from a triggering perspective. It was a little bit out of context. If you're just looking for one particular line, someone presents it, says, you know, one line, Dan said this in an email. We don't know what context that was. He might be having a little bit of a sparring thing going on with Graham, which could be quite likely. And, you know, we want to kind of know what the context that was, because that can make a really big difference between it being a real case and it not being something. Because, as we know, there's a lot of banter that goes on between the pair of them. We wouldn't really want to escalate that and cause lots of problems when we know that that might not necessarily be the case. So we've got things like in here, so if we've resolved that particular alert, we've kind of closed down that case. If we click on the pending, we can actually see some of the alerts that we've actually got going on here. So we see this is a Teams message. We can see the summary. So here we've got Deborah, there's a Teams message. She was sharing this particular information. And this has come up because these particular project code names we use, which are kind of a bit like confidential on those, some of those other labels that we've actually set up in here, and that's why this particular one has been flagged. We can also annotate that, as I mentioned to you before. We can kind of look at that and kind of come in here and we can actually draw some color, things around it, and we can put, you know, different types of things in here as well. And we can also look at that from a conversation perspective. So we can actually see over a period of time what's actually gone on over that particular conversation. Let's see, the message was edited here by the sender as well. So again, we can see, you know, over a period of time what's going on, if there's any particular alerts that we've actually got in here. We can see, again, you know, there's quite a lot that we can see in here across all those different things. So some of these might be emails as well, so we're not just talking about Teams messages, what's actually going on. We can see the different tags here, so we can see here that we've tagged these as compliant or non-resolvable. So there's quite a lot of information. Again, we can start to automate some of this stuff as well. So there's quite a lot that we can kind of start to do within communication compliance too. I think I'm going to have to stop there and go back to Dan's presentation.
Thank you very much, Hansel. I think England lost Italy in the final. There was certainly a lot of profanity that was being used across the team's platform. I'm sure insider risk analysts are going crazy. But look, what I would say in terms of next steps and how we do it is I'd encourage you again to start having these conversations inside your own organizations, or, you know, if you're a Microsoft partner, encouraging you to sort of run these trials and demos across your customer base. The first step is always that insider risk analytics. If you run that, hit the scan, it'll pull through the telemetry over a 24-hour period, and you can get a sense of how much of a problem this insider risk data exfiltration patterns are within the first 24 hours, and then you can get a sense of, right, do we need to be a bit more serious about building an insider risk management practice, And if that is the case, then it should consist of multiple people from different business functions, IT, HR, SecOps. It shouldn't just be IT admins looking at this. So just in terms of some resources, you can, as I mentioned, get started with Inside Risk Analytics. We've also got an interactive guide, which is great. This is literally a step-by-step guide, so you've seen this before, a view on how to, what that would look like in a sandbox environment to give you a sense of how an inside risk management policy should be set up if you don't have that today. Graham does a great, really good, is it 2 Minute Tuesdays on YouTube? Always worth a watch if you get stuck, because a lot of the time you can get a sense of what the technology, how the technology should be set up. And then also we've got some compliance manager score YouTube videos there as well, which is great. We've got some additional resources, and part of the, we've got a learning track for insider risk specifically. So if you go away and go on to microsoft.learn.com, go through the module that shows the insider risk management portal, and that'll take you through again setting up some of these policies and a lot of the new SC 500, 400 and 900 will have insider risk management content. So look, it's certainly an area that we're very passionate about, and we're doing a lot over the next couple of months to make sure we're voicing the new releases, all the new templates we're bringing out. And also there's a new connector into Visual Sentinel now as well, so you can actually have your insider risk management alerts now flagging to your scene, which should come along with the external adversaries that you've potentially seen there. So it's definitely a topic, internal adversaries as well as the external adversaries, and we're encouraging you to have this conversation across your own organisations and customer base. So thank you.
Yeah.
course programming.